Joel. Some folks say Joel, chapter 1. Call your attention to verse 3 and chapter 2, verse 27. Joel, chapter 1, verse 3 and chapter 2, verse 27. What shall I render unto God for all his mercies? Now, not to insult anyone's intelligence, if you can find Hosea and you can find Amos, then Joel or Joel up there next door, they would be right in between. Old Testament, Joel or Joel, chapter 1, focusing on verse 3, and chapter 2, focusing on verse 27. Are we there yet? Praise the name of the Lord. I am reading from the King James Version of the Bible, and what you read, we have the same lesson and the same thought that is being taught. Joel chapter 1, verse 3 reads, "Tell ye your children of it, and let your children tell their children, and their children another generation." Chapter 2, verse 27. Chapter 2, verse 27. "And ye shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I am the Lord your God, and none else. And my people shall never be ashamed."
Bridget.
Our subject for this Mother's Day lesson is the legacy we leave our children. The legacy we leave our children.
All right.
Lord have mercy. Leaving a legacy by training the next generation. Say that. Repeat after me. Leaving a legacy by training the next generation. Lord have mercy. Now, we're going to let this be a salah moment. You know, pause and think on these things and see how it affects you. And with that being said, leaving a legacy by training the next generation because of the legacy we want to leave our children, I want you to think of these questions. What kind of legacy do you want to leave behind for your family and your friends when you pass away, when you die? What kind of legacy do you want to leave when you pass away? When they come to say, "Always children."
Right.
How do you want others to remember you? Do you want to be known for how intelligent or educated you were? How articulate or animated you were? How well dressed and original as you were? Lord have mercy. What is your legacy that you are preparing now to leave those who will come after you, and they are watching you? We are watching you. Somebody's watching you. Lord have mercy. What is it that you really want to leave behind? What impression is it that we're trying to leave behind, church? You see, the reality is that every life leaves a legacy. That's just the point. There are no options. The truth is that right now we all, A-L-L, are working on the legacy we're going to leave, good, bad, or indifferent, and will become the legacy our family will live, and in turn will become the basis for the legacy that they leave, and so on and so on and so on. You see, our scriptural lesson for today's lesson, our teaching brings from a man of God in the Old Testament. God had given the prophet Joel a message to share with others. And then God sent something riveting, soul-stirring, and earth-shattering to the people. "Tell your children of it. And let your children tell their children and their children another generation." Lord, help me in here, children.
Yes.
Can you not see? God is making it very clear that we're to pass on the things that God has taught us to the next generation. We're not to keep our wonderful experience of learning God's truth to ourselves. We are to share what we have learned with the next generation. You see, examples matter, church. Examples matter. We're to share what we have learned with the next generation. And until I plug, if you will, my life into God's plan for caring for others, including the next generation, I'm missing out on some of the greatest joys which God has created me. Somebody, hear me up in here today.
All right.
You do not have to be a biological parent to do this.
Go ahead.
Every adult needs to be aware of his or her responsibilities to the next generation, and examples do matter. Anytime you're around somebody younger, you have a chance to positively influence him or her. And you need to take advantage of that opportunity. Whether it's a child here at Antioch, whether it's a neighborhood child that needs an older person in his or her life, someone in your own family, God wants you to share your knowledge. God wants you to share your wisdom. God wants you to share your experience. God wants you to be a mother. Now, do we do this? How do we do this? You see, the Bible is great, church. You see, it does not tell us what, it tells us how. How do we effectively communicate and convey the spiritual truth that God has shown us to the next generation? God's word places an emphasis in several areas, if you will. The first area of emphasis in the legacy we leave our children is the next generation needs wisdom and knowledge. Help me, Holy Ghost.
Yes.
The next generation needs wisdom and knowledge. You see, it is much better to have wisdom and knowledge than to have gold and silver. You can read all about that in Proverbs chapter 16, verse 15. The book of Proverbs, which was originally written for the next generation, says that it is better to have knowledge and wisdom than money, than treasures. There's nothing wrong with having money, but there's an order, there's a priority that we must indeed be mindful of. It's better to be spiritually smart than to have material possessions. You see, we must get this settled in our own minds if we're going to pass it on to the next generation. Remember, examples matter. Oh, help me, Holy Ghost is some kind of quiet up again. But that's all right. I said buckle your seatbelts. How do we get the next generation to see that wisdom and knowledge are better than silver and gold? Well, we teach them from a very young age to see themselves as stewards, as managers of the things that belong to God. We teach them not to worry as much about whose cookies are they, and in terms of gaining spiritual knowledge.
Yeah.
You see, I submit to you, the next generation needs to know how to live more than they know how to make a living, which brings us to emphasis number two. The next generation needs character as a moral compass.
Oh, I like that. All right. Tell them right. Character.
The next generation needs character
as a moral
compass. Lord have mercy. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 23 to 24, from the Message Bible teaches us, take on an entirely new way of life. A God-fashioned life renewed from the inside and work yourself into your conduct as God accurately replaces his character in you. You see, church, character is a word that describes morals and ethics and integrity. Say integrity with me.
Integrity.
It's about learning how to be the right kind of person and how to do the right kind of thing, especially in tough situations. Now, I don't stand here going smoke in anybody's direction. It is not always easy, but it can be done.
That's right.
It must be done if we are the Lord's chosen. So every generation needs character. Living without character, it's like trying to find your way around, let's say, Kinston with a map of Goldsboro, you know, trying to find your way around New York with a map of Kinston, you know. And children are misfocused, they're misdirected, and if they don't have the right map, they'll follow the wrong map unless we instill biblical principles in them.
That's right.
Help me, Holy Ghost.
Yes, sir.
Ooh, Jesus, have mercy. Jesus, have mercy. We, during Black History Month, for the past couple of years, have shared the Black Family Pledge. How it is that because we have forgotten so much of what our ancestors taught us, our children don't honor us. They don't respect us. They don't do as we used to do. I realize things change. But character and morals and ethics always must be in order because it pleases the Lord.
That's right.
Every generation needs character.
Yeah.
Lord have mercy. If we live without character, it's like trying to find your way again somewhere else with Roman. The GPS is going all kinds of anywhere. Whatever it is, you know who use it. You're out of range. You can't get what you need to get to where you need to go. Many reminders of the next generation will be following the wrong, members of the next generation shall be following the wrong map. We instill biblical principles in them, and that's the only way they're going to be able to go forward. So, two great ways, as I found in my studies, to pass character on to the next generation is protect their minds from evil thoughts. Proverbs chapter 15, verse 17 in the New Living Translation teaches us, a wise person is hungry for truth, while the fool feeds on trash. Ooh, help me, Holy Ghost. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. You've heard the old saying, anybody heard the old saying, garbage in, garbage out?
Oh, yeah.
If we want to keep the next generation innocent regarding evil so that they can mature in what is good, then we must help them feed on the truth and not on trash. Feed on truth and not on trash. We must especially, Lord have mercy, teach the next generation media discernment.
Amen.
Yeah.
Come on, man.
Media discernment. Lord have mercy. Ooh, the second one, protect their minds from evil thoughts, but don't protect them from difficulty. Now, this is one that, we don't want to deal with. And we do want to protect our children. We want to protect ourselves. But you can't protect them from everything. And if you try to keep them from not suffering and going through things, God knows we make, ooh, Lord, we're heading for a wreck on a highway, to be sure. Don't protect them from all difficulty. They're going to suffer growing pain. You can't stop them from cutting their teeth. It has to come through. It's a process that must be completed. We also have joy with our troubles, as Romans teach us, because we know that these troubles produce patience, and patience produces character, and character produces hope. In the New Century Version of the Bible, we are taught these things. You see, church, let us be reminded that maturity does not come with age. Maturity does not come with age. It comes with responsibility. Some people are mature at 17. Lord have mercy. While others are not mature at 37. Help me, Lord Jesus. What you talking about, preacher? Well, sometimes because they haven't taken on responsibility, they can't learn responsibility if you protect them from every single difficulty. They have to fall down and scrape their knees and hands sometimes. Now, the key to these two character promoters, that you have to have balance. You have to hear me and listen to me good, as mom say. Listen to me good, children. You have to have balance. If you go too far in either direction, in either extreme, you encourage an imbalance in character development. The next generation will be confronted with unwholesome ideas and suggestions, and our job is to help them filter through the stuff that hinders them, that cripples them, that causes them to suffer in the name of Jesus. Now, if we're not too strict, the spirit of the next generation is shattered. If we are too strict, then the next generation is shattered. And some of us know how it is being that iron hand. Our mama had an iron hand, but I thank God today. Ain't no telling where we would have been.
That's right.
I said it, I meant it, and I'm here to represent. Everybody really saying that? Right. We got to realize the truth and accept the truth. That it's a hard road that we have to hoe, but it makes a difference in the long run. If we're too strict, the spirit of the next generation is shattered. That's why the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 4 in the Amplified Bible, fathers, do not irritate and provoke your children to anger. Do not exasperate them to resentment, but rear them tenderly in the training and discipline and the counsel and admonition of the Lord. It's all about what we're doing to leave a legacy for our children.
That's right.
There's good advice for every adult interested in training the next generation. You got to be interested in the children. I got to say it. There's a different attitude, in my opinion, in the school system.
Yeah.
Folks want to get paid. Ain't studying the children. They will stay long enough to get their foot in the door so they can have a stepping stone to go somewhere else and will not dare relate to the children. You got to hug a little snide nose too. You got to love them just like they were own. Oh, Lord, leave them alone in the early. Leave them alone. Lord, have mercy. And it's not the child's fault of what's happening at home.
Amen.
It's not the child's fault. Oh, Jesus. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have
mercy.
There's so many. They didn't ask to be born because they're here. The responsibility is for the parents with the best they're able to do. And those of us who are around them, who, whether they don't want to say they're not, it's still our responsibility to say something. You good folks, I ain't gonna say it because so-and-so will get mad. Okay, the Lord will charge you for that.
Right.
You have an opportunity to speak into the life of a child.
Right.
Okay, go ahead and then the Earl. Lord, have mercy. The next generation, point three, emphasis three, needs convictions. They need values to live by. Values to live by. Hold tight to your convictions. Give it all to God. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 19, 13. Excuse me, the Message Bible teaches us. First, you gain wisdom and knowledge.
Right.
Then comes character. Next are your convictions. Character is being right. Conviction is having the fortitude to choose right. Life is choice driven. We make choices every day, and there are consequences to all of them. The deepest and most long-lasting blessing in life, the greatest joy and abiding inner peace, comes from making the right choices. We must pass this truth on to the next generation. Pay it again, Sam. The deepest and most long-lasting blessing in life, the greatest joy and abiding inner peace, comes from making the right choices. We must pass the truth on to the next generation. One of the many great biblical illustrations of conviction comes from the book of Daniel. Anybody remember Daniel? You know his story?
Oh, yeah.
You know how Daniel persevered, how Daniel did not let go his faith that he believed. He didn't sugarcoat it. He didn't try to make a way for himself. He didn't try to make a name for himself. He didn't sell his soul to the devil to get what he thought he might have wanted. He trusted God. He was a next generation Jew, a young man who took pagan captive as a young child, but it did not cause him to lose his faith, to release all he had learned as a young child. Do you remember what happened to Daniel? Come on. God promised him, and others respected him because he was a person of conviction.
Conviction.
Kings wanted to know what Daniel thought, and he became their advisor.
Right.
Well, look at it, church. Convictions produce passion, and passionate people change the world for the better. It isn't the person who lives a happy-go-lucky life, don't worry. And it's okay to have those times sometimes, but we need to give them a little burden sometimes. Don't worry, be happy. But it is a person who remembers that the influence, the right kind of influence, is for the success in life as we leave a legacy for our children. It's the person who has courage to live by their commitments. Anybody remember the cowardly lion and the wizard of Oz?
Uh-huh.
What's the cowardly lion want?
Courage.
He wanted courage.
If I were king of the forest.
He wanted courage. He wanted courage. Do we want the courage for the children, to encourage the children to stand up for that courage? Lord have mercy. You see, children must have convictions. Because if not, then they are captivated by the values of our culture. The values of our culture. Peace, pleasure. I want to feel good. The values of our culture. Peace, possessions. I want to have a lot of stuff. The values of our culture, prestige. I want other people to envy me. The values of our culture, peace, power. I want to be in control. How do we effectively pass our convictions onto the next generation? I'm glad you asked. You see, convictions must be modeled. They are more caught than taught. Lord have mercy. If you are passionate about your convictions, then the members of the next generation that you influence will pick up on that passion. If your life exhibits an honest reflection of what you say and you believe in, they will know the true value of conviction. You, Lord have mercy, you reap what you sow. You walk the talk, but you talk the talk. You got to walk the talk as well, too. And our behavior has an enormous influence on the behavior of the next generation. Our behavior has an enormous influence on the behavior of the next generation. But if we want to direct the behavior of the future generation, we must look at our own behavior.
Yes,
play that again, Sam. Our behavior has an enormous influence on the behavior of the next generation. And if we want to direct the behavior of future generations, we must look at our own behavior. I was blessed to come to Christ in a church that cared deeply about the next generation. Quite honestly, I don't know where I would be today if not for that church. You see, there was a philosophy in that church that enhanced the importance of focusing on the needs of the next generation. You're keeping the connection across the generations. I know it began with the pastors we had. We had some pastors that while I was between the age of 12 when I came to know Christ, and 18 when I went away to school. During those years, many, many tremendous effects were made upon other youth in our church. And I have not seen, I don't know where I would have been if not for that atmosphere here at Antioch.
Uh-huh.
How did it begin for you? At what age? Between what age? What changed you? What challenged you? What kept you? What impacted you the most? What was the effectiveness of having someone prepare you for the next generation? You see, there's so many things that we have been taught. Did your mother teach you how to appreciate a job well done? If you're going to kill each other, do it outside. I just finished cleaning. Did your mother teach you religion? You better pray that will come out of that carpet. Did your mother teach you logic? Because I said so, that's why. Did your mother teach you how to meet a challenge? Answer me when I talk to you. Don't talk back to me. Did your mother teach you foresight? Make sure you wear clean underwear in case you are in an accident. Did your mother teach you irony? Keep laughing and I'll give you something to cry for. Did your mother teach you the science of osmosis? Shut your mouth and eat your supper. Did your mother teach you about contortionism? Will you look at the dirt on the back of your neck? Did your mother teach you about behavior modification? Stop acting like your daddy. Did your mother teach you about envy? There are millions of less fortunate children in the world who don't have a wonderful mother like you do. Did your mother teach you justice? One day, you'll have kids, and I hope they turn out just like you. Leaving a legacy by passing stuff on to the next generation can be serious business, but don't ever forget to laugh. Don't ever forget to laugh. And while you are laughing, let it be great, great, great in prayer and great in encouragement and great in desire for them to be better than we were. And pray that they will undertake the same desire to prepare others to continue to go forward. To continue to go forward. May the work happen. Speak for me. May the work have done. Speak for me. When I'm resting in my grave and there's nothing more to be said.
Jesus.